In this screencast, we'll provide an overview of latent heat as well as look at how we can use physical property data to help us with latent heat calculations. So the term latent heat is used to describe heat transfer that's associated with a phase change, and specifically a phase change at constant temperature and pressure. So by considering the phase as the only variable that's changing, we are differentiating latent heat from sensible heat, which is the heat transfer associated with a change in temperature. The phase changes that we're most concerned with in chemical engineering operations are the transition between a solid and a liquid, as well as a liquid and a vapor. And the transition of a solid to a liquid is obviously melting, and the change in specific enthalpy associated with that change is the heat of melting, which is given the variable of h hat sub m. The transition between a liquid and a vapor is vaporization, and the specific enthalpy change associated with that process is the heat of vaporization. Both of these quantities, the heat of melting and the heat of vaporization, are determined experimentally but can usually be looked up in different references. So it's usually tabulated. You can easily find this in Felder and Rousseau in Appendix B1. You can generally find these in thermodynamic textbooks as well as Perry's. And they're tabulated as a function of temperature and pressure. So it's important that these are specified when we look these quantities up. And if we want to look at an example of how we can use this data, we can look at a simple example of the vaporization of water. So in this case, we want to calculate the heat that's required to vaporize 100 moles of water per second at 100 C in atmospheric pressure. We also want to calculate the heat that's required to condense 100 moles per second at 100 in atmospheric pressures as well. The vaporization process is illustrated here in the flowchart. We're trying to calculate the latent heat, so we want Q in kilojoules per second. And we have representative data here that was pulled from the appendices in Felder and Rousseau. So here the heat of vaporization is shown as a function of temperature and pressure. We're at 100 C and 1 atmosphere. So the heat of vaporization is 40.66 kilojoules per mole. If we want to calculate the latent heat, we can start with the open system energy balance. And in this case, the open system energy balance reduces to Q is equal to delta H, which is assuming that there's no work and we're neglecting any changes in kinetic and potential energy. The heat of vaporization is given as a specific quantity. In other words, it's given to us on a per mole basis. So we can rewrite our energy balance as Q is equal to N dot, which is the molar flow rate, times our specific enthalpy change, which in this case is the heat of vaporization. So plugging in our numbers here, we have 100 moles per second. For our molar flow rate, our published heat of vaporization is 40.66 kilojoules per mole. So in this case, Q is equal to 4,066 kilojoules per second, or kilowatts. In the second part of the problem, we were asked to calculate what the latent heat is to condense 100 moles per second of water at the same temperature and pressure, which is simpler than it looks at first. For the condensation process, we've done most of the work already. You will not find in thermodynamic textbooks a heat of condensation. And if we think about what's happening in this particular case, as we change phase from vapor to a liquid, it's the exact opposite of the vaporization process. And if we consider that specific enthalpy is a state function, in other words, it only depends on the initial and final condition, we're using the same final and initial conditions and reversing them. So the heat of condensation is equal to, but opposite in sign, of the heat of vaporization at the same temperature and pressure. So in this case, for the heat of condensation, our energy balance is N dot times the opposite of the heat of vaporization. So the latent heat to condense the same amount of water at the same temperature and pressure is simply negative 4,066 kilojoules per second. The same holds for the freezing process. It is equal to an opposite in sign of the heat of melting at the same temperature and pressure. To better understand what the heat of vaporization represents physically, we can relate the data that we've been given to a phase diagram for pure water. A schematic of the phase diagram is shown below. For pure water, which shows pressure versus temperature and the regions at which the different phases exist. So here we have a solid. At higher temperature, we have a liquid. And at higher temperature and low pressure, we have a vapor. And the region that divides the liquid and the vapor region is where the phase change occurs and where we can maintain two phases at equilibrium. So this pressure temperature line represents the vapor liquid equilibrium line where we can maintain two phases. We can use the conditions from our example to describe the behavior of water on this diagram. So for example, if we specify the pressure as atmospheric, and this diagram is not shown to scale, the diagram illustrates that there is one temperature at which water will change phase between the liquid and the water. So we intuitively know that that temperature is the boiling point at 100 degrees C. If at atmospheric pressure we're at 99 degrees C, we'll maintain pure liquid. If we're at 101 degrees at atmospheric pressure, we'll maintain pure vapor. But at atmospheric pressure and 100, we can transfer phase between the liquid and the vapor, and we can maintain both phases at equilibrium if we had a system of pure water. And it is at this temperature and pressure, and this region on the phase diagram, that the heat of vaporization is given. So the heat of vaporization specifically represents the transition between liquid and the vapor phase at this point, at this pressure and temperature on the phase diagram. The diagram also shows that for any pressure, not only one atmosphere, there is only one temperature at which the phase change occurs. This is true for water as well as any other pure species. If we change the pressure, or if we change the temperature, we are moving up. If we are increasing along the vapor-liquid equilibrium line, if we increase the temperature, the pressure is not free to change independently. So if we specify the temperature at which the phase change occurs, the pressure is fixed as well. So it is not coincidental here, as we increase the temperature from 100 to 102, that the pressure changes as well. As we're increasing the temperature, we're increasing the pressure, and we are moving up along the vapor-liquid equilibrium curve for that particular species. The effect of the change in temperature and pressure, for example, if we increase, we're increasing the pressure, and we are decreasing the heat of vaporization. So as we increase the temperature, it takes less energy to vaporize the liquid to the vapor phase. If we go all the way up the vapor-liquid equilibrium line, we will eventually reach the critical point, in other words, TC and PC. The significance of the critical point is that we no longer can maintain differentiable phases at equilibrium. So we lose the ability to differentiate the liquid from the vapor phase, and instead we have a supercritical fluid that exhibits the properties of one phase. So as we approach the critical point, the heat of vaporization approaches zero, where we can no longer maintain two distinct phases at equilibrium.